I'll buy you one, Bob. I don't think I can get it to you. Turn around, Mark, and give it to the guy in the green, buddy, by knocking out on your head. All right, how are we doing? You do not want to see me up here very much longer, I know that. Sorry, I don't have any more. Hey, a couple of things, you guys. If you need to go to the bathroom, go ahead and go. You need some water, it's still outside. Please don't stand on the chairs. All right? They're brand new, and the church is brand new, and we want to respect the Lord's property. Whoever's kids these are, if you would like to, you know, sometimes New Year's resolutions, you need to carry them out just like children. So let's carry them out. Whose is this? Yeah, you need to go sit down, young man. That's right. I'm not messing around here tonight. This is my favorite band. You guys wouldn't have been happy if I let him sit right there, would you?
No!
All right. How are we doing, guys? Are we almost there? Or Jeff, what do we got? 3 minutes? 2 minutes? 3 minutes. Did I ever tell you guys about when I was a child? Time's up. What other things could I share? What's an important thing, Joe, that I could share tonight?
What Petra means to you.
Well, I kind of shared what Petra means to me. First time I saw him in concert. You know, the only thing I do wonder about is, you know the song, Got to Take a Stand and Kill the Old Man? Remember that song? What's up with that? It's a Christian band. They're talking, I've got the blood of an innocent man all over me. Yeah? You ready? Okay, we're ready. Okay, you guys, before they come out, are they ready, Mark? Are they primed? Are they at the door? What am I doing with this microphone?
Thank you.
There's still radio show.
Oh, are they? Hi, guys. Are they ready? Okay, you guys, you know what? As many of you know, sadly but truly, Petra has decided to hang it up. And this is their last year in ministry. And this is one of the last concerts many of you are probably the last concert of them you're ever going to see. And so why don't you guys stand up and scream them on stage, okay? Scream them on stage. Go.
I thought we'd be doing something besides Amazing Grace. It's all about who you know. What do you have? Anybody want to hear my life story?
Thank you. It's all about who you know. It's all about who you know. It's all about who you know.
This year, and we're actually very excited about it. I'm scared. I don't know what I'll be doing after that. So, but actually, I want you to know that we've been so super blessed over 33 years of ministry. And it's because of people like you that chose to use Petra's ministry, and we thank you so much for that.
Yeah!
like to introduce to you the founding member of the long-lasting band called Petra, Mr. Bob Hart.
Some of you might know I was off the road for almost 8 years, and since coming back on the road about 3 years ago, almost, it has been a fantastic experience to not only see the same kinds of things happening in Petra concerts as when I left, and see those all over the world. I mean, we've had the privilege of being in so many great other countries. We just got back again from Europe. We were in Australia at the beginning of the year. At the end of last year, we were in India, played literally on the side of a mountain for thousands of people in India who knew Petra's music. Now, you don't have to be a genius to figure out that there is no way that a human being could engineer something like that to happen. If people in India hear about this band, we know in our hearts that God did it.
Amen.
And that makes it so exciting for us to be there and see how God works. And we've heard from so many of our fans of how much our music has meant to their lives, their spiritual lives, and that is so rewarding for us. It makes all of the things that we did that seemed so laborious through so many years, all of the things that we felt like we had to put up with, all of the things that were discouraging to us, that seemed to be taking us in a negative direction, all of those things, they don't add up to a hill of beans when you figure out what God has really done with what you've been doing. And it has been so rewarding for us. So we are just so happy, as John said, to be out here saying thank you to all of you for allowing God into your lives and allowing, you know, our music to be a part of your spiritual life. And that means an awful lot to us. So again, thank you. We're going to be doing some new songs and some old songs tonight. And right now we got a few oldies for you, if that's okay.
world. Everybody wants that perfect world where you always have everything is great and getting an A here. Without Jesus Christ, it does not exist. But with Him, we do know all about the perfect world.
Oops.
Thank you. song we want to dedicate. In fact, you know, I think the man who we actually wrote this song for, Bob, let me know about this morning. Your pastor here, Mike Reed. We just want to thank him for being the inspiration of this next song. I believe in the Virgin Mary. I believe.
most important doctrine in the Bible is the fact that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. The Apostle Paul said, without the resurrection of Jesus Christ, there is no Christianity. Some of you may wonder, how can you believe something that happened so long ago? How can you believe that Jesus Christ is really real? I asked that very same question 35 years ago. Man, I am old school, I'm telling you. 35 years ago, there was a guy I had grown up with who'd moved out here to California. And something happened to him when he was out here. And he started going to a certain church in Costa Mesa. where all those weird Jesus freaks went. I think it was called, what was it? Calvary or something. And he came back to visit my small town in Ohio, and I had heard there was something that happened to him. And I was really curious, because I was hearing some pretty wild things. So I asked him to come over and talk to me about it. I invited him over. I was a sitting duck. I mean, I think back, I can't believe it. You know, I asked him to witness to me. Well, luckily, he wasn't too busy. And he came over, and he talked to me, and he told me a bunch of things that happened to him. He told me he had gotten saved. Now, for me, I had grown up in a church. But it might come as a surprise to some of you, not every church believes in being saved. Some churches believe that, you know, it's just an intellectual thing that you say, yeah, I believe there was a person named Jesus who was really good and did a lot of good things, and so I guess I'm going to heaven. There are churches who believe that. There are churches who believe that you don't have to do any choosing at all, that God chooses you, and maybe you'll be lucky enough to find out sometime in your life. Well, this was news to me when he said, I got saved. I came to a place in my life where I said to God, I don't have the answers. I need you. If you're there, God, do something for me. And he said, I've planted the seed in you, said that to me, and I hope it'll grow. And he left me some tracks. Well, for the next 2 weeks, I couldn't think of anything else. All I could think of, I'd get up in the morning, I'd look at the sky, I'd look at everything, I'd say, is there really a God? Because you see, even though I went to church, I saw all the phoniness that was there in the church. It just seemed like a social club, the church I went to. So I thought, you know, if this is what Christianity is, I don't want to be part of that. But it intrigued me, is there really a God? Is he really there? Does he know anything about me? I mean, who am I that God would know something about me, let alone want to do something in my life? But because he had told me that God had done something in his life, that little hope was there. That maybe, just maybe, it was true. Maybe God really could be real to me. And after about 2 weeks, one night I just felt really strongly that God was doing something, was calling me somehow. I was sitting alone on a couch in the living room in northwestern Ohio, and I had those tracks in front of me that he had given me. And, you know, after some of the things he told me had happened to him, I figured that Jesus was going to show up that night. And I sat there and I prayed and I said, God, if you're there, see, I didn't have much faith at all. I said, God, if you're there, if you can hear me, I want you in my life. You know, appear to me, show me yourself. And when I opened my eyes, no, I didn't see Jesus, but I was looking no focusing, I was looking right at a track, and the front words on the front of the track said, "Love is patience." And it just stuck out like, and I, you know, it's hard to describe something that's very personal, but that to me was like, wow. And over the next few months and weeks, I began to see more and more God working in my life. I began to see that He really was there, that He knew all about me. How did I know? Well, I would pray about things. I had gone back to college at that point, and things didn't go right when I got back to college. Have you ever noticed how after you get saved, things don't always go just perfect? Does that happen to anyone else, or am I alone now? Okay? You know, it's sort of like God throws you out there and throws a bunch of problems your way and sees what you're going to do about it. You know? Are you going to run back to your old ways and treat them problems the way you used to? Or are you going to stand there and have some faith? Are you going to dip down and see and put God to the test? Put His word to the test. You see, He says, call upon His name. He says, ask and you will receive. So, not everything was going right, so I asked Jesus Christ to help me. And I began to see prayers answered. And, you know, at first I thought, well, that's just a coincidence. But, you know what, I'm not going to forget that. I'm going to kind of put that over here in this file in my mind under possible coincidences. And then something else would happen, I'd pray about that, and there'd be another answer, and I'd say, you know what, I'm going to put that right over there, possible coincidences, in that file right there. And it happened again, and again, and again, and all of a sudden, I had a whole big old file full of coincidences, and I said, you know what, there is no way in the world that that stuff that I prayed for could all happen, and there not be a God. And that's what it took for me to understand how God wanted to work in my life, how God works through prayer, how not everything goes right when you become a Christian at first. But God wants you to stick to it and call on His name and depend on Him and learn that all of these other things that we trust in this world are going to fall away. They're going to disappoint. They're going to fail. But the only thing that we can stand on is on Christ, the solid rock. I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. How true those words are of that old hymn. Tonight, question we have for you is, what are you standing on? There might be people here tonight who come in out of curiosity. Somebody invited you and thought, yeah, I'll go see this Christian band. I'll go sit there and hear what they have to say. If you're here and you're listening tonight, and your heart is listening, what we want you to hear is that there's a God that's real. We've experienced Him every single day in our 33-year ministry. We have felt the presence of the Holy Spirit here tonight in this room. We hope that you have too. If you're sitting there and you're wondering, can this be true, like I was 35 years ago? Is there really a God? Does He care about me? Does He want to do something for me? Why would He want to do something for me? We want you to hear that God loves you. He loves you tonight. And God is no respecter of persons. What He's done for all so many other people here and us, He wants to do for you. Is He calling you tonight? Are you feeling that same pull of the Holy Spirit that I felt that night, alone on that couch in the living room? Would you bow your heads for a moment? We're going to give you an opportunity, because it would be such a shame to play Christian songs all night. Songs that sing about the love of God, about salvation, about knowing Christ. And to have you walk out of here and not have an opportunity to know what so many people in this room already know, to experience what so many others in this room tonight have experienced. The joy of salvation. Tonight, He wants to come in your life. We're going to say a simple prayer. And if you're out there, you've never invited Christ in your life. You never come to a place like I did that night, where you turned it over to Him, where you said, I can't do it by myself. I don't have the answers. I need Christ in my life. If that's where you're at tonight, then all you need to do is pray along with this prayer. It's not any special words. It's not any more special than I prayed that night. But if you pray it, you mean it in your heart. Jesus Christ will come in your life right here, right now, tonight. Let's all pray together. Repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross for my sins. I ask Him into my life now. To forgive my sins. And make me a new person. Reveal yourself to me every day. And I thank you for saving me. And I believe that you have. Because you said whosoever. Shall call on the name of the Lord. Shall be saved. And I call on you now. In Jesus' name. And all the people said. Amen. That wasn't hard, was it? No. It didn't hurt. But if you prayed that prayer for the first time, something changed in your life. In fact, I want to ask you right now. Just lift your hand for a minute. If you prayed that for the first time, how many of you prayed that for the first time? Thank you. How many? Fantastic. Boy, I could stand up here tonight and talk all night about all the things that are going to happen in your life, but, you know, we've got some other people here tonight that want to spend a moment talking to you if you prayed that prayer. And so what I'm going to ask everyone to do, everyone in the auditorium, to just please stand up. Would you do that? I want to make it easy for people to move around, because I want those of you who just prayed that prayer for the first time to come forward, to come right down here in the front, so that somebody can meet with you and talk with you. If you do that, just step out from wherever you are. Nobody's going to do anything weird to you. They love you. They love you. They've been praying for you. You said to me, down here in front, just go to another room where you can talk for just a moment. They're going to tell you some things that are going to be really valuable in the next few weeks. Did you pray that prayer for the first time? Did you lift your hand? Come on forward. Come on down here. Yeah, that's what it's about. So you don't need to be ashamed or embarrassed to come forward. You know, whenever I feel ashamed or embarrassed about something in Christ, I think about that Christ was not ashamed or embarrassed when He carried a cross through the middle of the town and people spat on Him and called Him names. He wasn't embarrassed to do that for you and I. He knew what He was doing. You don't need to be embarrassed to come forward for Him tonight, to take a stand for Jesus Christ tonight. Would you come? I'm going to wait just a minute more. And there might be, while these people are making up their minds, there might be some others here, maybe some Christians, who say, yeah, I made a commitment to Christ a long time ago, but I sure haven't been living it. I sure haven't been living the way I need to live. I haven't been experiencing all that God has for me. And I feel like I need to renew something tonight. Don't you be afraid or ashamed to come too. If God's going to do something great for you. Let me just ask you how people are coming. Does anybody else besides me feel the Holy Spirit in this place tonight? When God's Spirit visits us in that special kind of way, He wants to do something. He wants to make us different afterwards, doesn't He? It's not just so we can have a good time and go out and rah-rah. It's so that He can do something that changes us forever. Let Him do that tonight for you. You know what God has put His finger on maybe in your life tonight? Something He wants to do for you, you know He does. Let Him do that. Come forward. Can I have a chance for somebody to just pray with you for a minute? That's all we're asking. That's all we're asking. And while these people are going to make their way, we're going to do one more song, and it's a song that is a special kind of prayer for Petra. We pray this kind of prayer every night before we go on. The name of the song is, Lord, Send Your Power. Send Your Power. We need His power today more than ever, don't we? In this world, the way it is, we need His power. Would you join us as we sing this and sing along with us? And we want to ask you to invite the Lord's power into the city of San Diego. Does San Diego need the power of Jesus Christ? I believe it does. I believe it does. Let's sing that song together.
Folks, we have volunteers here. Can you do me a favor and volunteers, just hold up your hands. Praise God. See these people around you? They're here to help. They're here to help and talk with you. They prayed for you ever since this concert was conceived. If you can trust them, they are people that want to talk to you. And thank you again for being part of this evening.
Show your power. Show your power, oh Lord on high. Show your power, oh Lord on high. Oh Lord on high.
Thank you so much for coming with us. We're going to be out and sign autographs a little bit as soon as we get all cleaned up and stuff. And again, thank you for the years of ministry that you've allowed us.